Good afternoon, everybody. How are we doing? Yeah, woo! Welcome to the Lightning Talk session. My name's Stephen Lead. I'm from Full Extent in Sydney. And thank you, Alex. We've got a very exciting session for you this afternoon. We've got 15 presentations from a range of experts and practitioners in open source, open data. And everyone that I've spoken to said they're more excited and more nervous about their five-minute talk here today than they were about their big talks during the week. Now, we're going to be very strict about the five-minute time limit, so we've got a little timer on the table here. Be very strict about the time limit. Now, when you guys hear the timer go off, I need your help. Could you please do a slow clap for me until the presenter stops? Can we just do a little test now? Slow clap. Yep. Getting louder and louder and louder until they finally shut up. Exactly. That's what we're going to do. So I'm going to start my timer, and Alex and John have very considerately put me first in the talks. So I'm going to start the timer. I'm going to do my talk now. Okay, so here's my talk on a map-centric travel blog that I wrote. So this is me. This is my wife, Gloria, or Glo, and she's from England. I'm from Australia. We met in Canada. We've been traveling the world together ever since we met back in 2001. Now, I've always loved travel photography, so long before there was Flickr or long before there was Facebook or Instagram, I put together a travel blog using Tumblr, and that's what I've been using ever since. It's getting a bit old and a bit long in the tooth, but that's what I've been using. Now, the beautiful thing about being a developer these days is that everything I need is on my laptop. I've got a VPN to connect to work, I've got GitHub for the code, most of the stuff's in the cloud anyway, so I could work from anywhere. So I decided last year to take my family on a round-the-world trip. Now, being a good geek, my first thought was, I better do a new blog. The blog's getting a bit old. So I looked around at some of the best blogs that are out there. And even if they're beautifully designed, they've all got the same flaw as you're seeing here. They treat location as an alphabetical list. Australia is next to Austria. And I knew I could do better than that. So looking at my old blog, I could see that the hint of what I wanted to do was already in there in the blog post. Every post knew where it was. It had the title, Hanmer Springs, Berlin, when in Dublin. So the location was there already in the blog. It seemed to do something with it. What I decided I wanted to do with my blog is make it geo-aware. It had to know about the places. I wanted it to be map-centric, but I didn't want the map to take away from the photos and the text, so it had to be unobtrusive. So those were my requirements. Like many optimists and fools before me, I decided to write my own blog. And I'm a Rails developer, so I decided to use Rails. Now, Rails is written on the back end in Ruby, and it allows you to use the front end JavaScript code. What I love about Rails is it's got a bunch of gems, which are functions written by other people, which you can just insert easily. One of those is the geocoder gem. As you'd expect, you give it a place name, Paris, and it returns lat long. What's lovely about this gem, though, is with one line of code, it just binds into the application. So I set or change the place name, and it automatically goes into the right spot as a latitude, longitude column. So here I've got a geo-enabled table, basically a geocoded table. So let's take a look at what I did once I had a geocoded table of all of the blog posts. So I put together this blog, and I wanted it to be photo-centric. So the first thing you see is a header across the top with a photo. Then there are photos further down as you scroll. You can also click on one of the photos and then get a full-screen photo, which you can then zoom through. So they're pretty cute, aren't they? Just like a normal blog, you can go previous or next blog post. So here I'm going to the previous post, and you can see it's zooming into Basel. Here's where we're starting to get the hints of the geo-enablement. The post knows that it's in Basel, Switzerland, and there is a map. Now that map is interactable, so you can use the map to find other blog posts. So now we jump across to London. And now when we click on that, we're going to the London post, and now the whole thing changes to be about London. And so the photos are about London. If we now jump to the previous post, we're now going to jump from London to Tokyo. And looking at the map here, I can go into full screen mode. So the map isn't just a little map, it's a full screen map as well. And now I can start to interact with all of the posts that I've written over the years. What's nice about this is it gives you a totally different view of the same content. Rather than having to go next, previous, you're seeing it in a map. So we'll jump from over there across into Central America. And we'll jump down into Panama. And so we've managed to go across space and time. This is like 6 months later from where I was in Tokyo. I ended up in Panama. Now we go back into the full screen mode. You notice that in full screen mode, we keep the same extent as before. And now we jump across to Guatemala. So you can see it's really easy and intuitive way to view the same content rather than being just on the text. We're seeing it in a map. Now, not everyone here is a JavaScript programmer. So for you guys on the left-hand side, there's some nice photos to look at. For everyone else, let's look at the code and how it works. What's nice about Rails is you can add .json to a AJAX request, and it returns the posts as... The timer hasn't gone off. Give me a chance, guys. Yeah, wait for the timer. So here we're seeing the marker clusters. So basically, return it as JSON, convert to GeoJSON, and then see it as markers, as clustered markers. The way that the bookmarks work, when you open up the map, it knows that there was a cookie set for the last lat long, so it opens up with that lat long. And then so I set the cookies every time the map pans or zooms, I set those cookies. I'm going to have to jump forward because I'm running out of time. Okay, so to summarise, the idea was that it's geo-aware, that it has a map front and centre, but it's not the map is not obtrusive. So there's no table of contents. You can start clapping now. Okay, so I'll finish up by saying that if you wanted to have a look at the map, it's at stephenglow.com, and you can download the code from there. Thank you. Okay, so next I'm going to bring up Cameron Shorter. Now, one of the advantages of using commercial software is that you get usually a nice setup.exe to run it. With open source software, it's often a bit more difficult. And Cameron's going to tell us about ways to make that easier. So please welcome Cameron Shorter.
No, I'm just going to talk. Okay. OsteoLive is a project I've been involved in. It's a Linux distribution that has been pre-installed with over 50 geospatial open source applications, along with sample data sets, overviews, and quick starts. You can boot it up from a USB or run it in a virtual machine, and you can immediately start playing with the best Osteo has to offer. It is used for training, trialing new applications, and outreach. We launched it at the International Phosphagy event here in Australia in 2009, and it has grown and attracted hundreds of contributors since then. In this cut-down lightning talk, I'll introduce its more popular packages, which effectively compresses a Phosphagy conference into a 5-minute elevator pitch. So our focus with OsteoLive is identifying and promoting robust and sustainable projects. Our metrics page, our metrics webpage, aggregates the dashboards from OpenHub, and you can use it to gain insights into each project's health and developer engagement. So let's now look at the popular applications installed on OsteoLive, starting with the desktop. This is where we find the heavy lifting applications. QGIS allows you to visualize, manage, edit, analyze data, and then compress and then compose printable maps. It supports numerous vector, raster, database formats, as well as tools and external plugins, such as the GRASS analytics module. GRASS provides powerful raster vector processing. It includes hundreds of tools for spatial modeling, visualization, and analytics. And moving now into the browser, we've got browser clients that are used to publish maps and increasingly are also delivering functionality which previously was only available in the desktop. OpenLayers and Leaflet are JavaScript libraries for putting maps into web pages. OpenLayers aims to be comprehensive. Leaflet is more lightweight, targeting simplicity. Cesium is a JavaScript library for creating 3D globes and 2D maps in a browser. It uses WebGL for hardware accelerated graphics and is tuned for dynamic data visualization. GeoNode is a content management system. It supports loading, editing, publishing, searching, and commenting on maps and associated metadata. And then moving on to web services. These are accessed via a URL and return maps in various formats, usually based upon OGC standards. GeoServer and MapServer are the leading open source applications for publishing maps to the internet. GSServer is Java-based, while MapServer is written in C. And while not as performant, QGIS server is handy for publishing your QGIS project directly in as a web map service. GeoNode and PyCSW provide catalog services for maintaining metadata about datasets. GeoNetwork is an older Java-based project, and PyCSW is lightweight and quick to set up. OSGeoLive includes two sensor observation service projects and three web processing services. A web processing service allows you to move complex processing to a central server, and this is useful for accessing large dynamic data sets such as climate models. And at the bottom of the stack are the databases. We've got a few of those. PostGIS spatially enables a popular Postgres database. It's stable, fast, standards compliant, includes hundreds of spatial functions, and is currently the most widely used open source spatial database. Next time, we cover the spatial tools. GDAL and OGR provide command line tools to translate between spatial formats and projections. R provides a command line interface to powerful statistical computing and graphic algorithms and exceeds at analyzing spatial data sets. And of course, all these tools become much more useful with access to free data. OpenStreetMap is crowdsourced map data of the world, which has grown to become one of the most detailed sources of local scale maps. OSGeoLive includes a city-sized extract of OpenStreetMap, and we also have some sample data sets in other formats as well to demonstrate some of the examples. So this has just been a taster. Check out our project overviews and quick starts on our website for more details. And then go and boot a USB or a virtual machine and get some real-world experience in using OSGeo applications.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you, Cameron Shorter. You guys are very, very impatient up the back there. All right.
Calm down.
Calm down, yeah. Give it a chance. All right. Yep. So next up, we have Nathan Woodrow, one of the key QGIS contributors, and he's going to talk about generating JavaScript code from QGIS expressions for fun, in inverted commas.
Indeed.
Please welcome Nathan.
Thank you. So exactly, generating JavaScript from QGIS expressions. Exactly, but why would you want to do that? Indeed. Crazy indeed. Mainly for fun and learning, because why not? In the end, sometimes it's Saturday night is nothing else to do, so why not? But also for QGIS Web. So if you haven't used QGIS Web before, Tom Chadwin, I think his name is, he developed QGIS Web, which takes a QGIS project, dumps it out to OpenLayers or Leaflet. He had a problem trying to get the rule-based expressions to work in QGIS Web, but he was trying to use regex to parse the whole expression, and I almost died when I saw that. You can use regex, but friends don't let friends do that. So we take a QGIS expression and then we generate a JavaScript function which actually has the actual expression generated inside it, and then the result is just calling a function, and then that parsed int function func to int function is actually just a wrapper on that as well. So why what the hell's going on? So QGIS expressions are actually they generate an abstract syntax tree underneath. But it's not that kind of tree. It's that kind of tree. We take the program and take the expression, break it down to all individual nodes and how they connect to each other, which means we can take that abstract syntax tree and generate pretty much anything we want from it. So we take the input node, which is the root level. We walk the tree. We say what type of node it is. In this case, we're going to call handle binary. So if it's binary node, which is a plus, a minus, an equals, all that sort of stuff. So the handle binary function just looks like that. Takes another node and walks each left and right side. And if the operator is alike, then we generate some like syntax that's equivalent for JavaScript. Same for not like, same for not in case sensitive like. Handle function is exactly the same. We walk the expression again, get the function that you're trying to call, generate a stub function that would do the actual logic, and then walk all the arguments in that are internal and do the same thing again. So that way you can have functions inside functions inside functions. So basically the steps are take a QGIS expression, walk tree, generate expression, and profit. Haven't quite worked out how to do the profit stat yet. That's why we're all here. But can we go down deeper than that? Can we go to something like LOL code? If you haven't seen LOL code before, yeah, you can look it up. But I didn't do that because I couldn't get it to build. But you could, but I'm not going to. That's it. Wow.
You got a couple of minutes left if you want to just keep on talking. I think I scared everyone with the whole like slow clapping thing, I think, yeah. All right, so next up we've got Niall Dawson, who's going to tell us about adventures in reverse engineering, Esri style, and layer files. Please welcome Niall Dawson.
I don't know if I should go for like a minute and a half to beat Nathan. This is me in another life. I'm here to talk about Slayer. Slayer is a little tool that was developed to get these layer files, which are basically like a symbol set. So it's a way of styling layers and embedding all the information about how they should be symbolized inside that one file, like this. So they usually have, you know, thousands of symbols and stuff in there. They tend to be distributed along with official data sets. So it might be like you go to your government portal, you get your data, and it also has a layer file sitting next to it that's got the official symbology for that layer. Unfortunately, they're locked up in purgatory. What I mean by that is a layer file is actually an ArcGIS format. Like I said, they're locked up in purgatory. So the Slayer story starts at SMEC. In SMEC, there was an official government data for geotech, which came with basically like thousands and thousands of symbols for all these different kind of geotech categories. And they all had certain colours that you had to respect. We needed to get those from the Esri world into the QGIS world, but because there was thousands and thousands, no one's going to sit there and copy all those colours across. And basically there's every way you could think of to get them out has been blocked in some way by people. So the mission was to get them out and save them and take them into the promised QGIS land like this. But like I said, unfortunately, layer files, they're a binary format. There's no specifications for them. They're all locked up and they're encrypted. Locked up. So after much of this, Slayer was born. And Slayer is basically a Python kind of library tool, something, parser, which could kind of work out what those little binary bits in the layer formats were and turn them back into something usable, like the colours for those symbols. So the very first version of Slayer was really, really primitive, but it did let us get these couple of thousand colours and symbols for that geotech library layer back to the wonderful QGIS promised land, and there was much rejoicing. the initial roadblock we hit was with colours. So basically, there's a certain format of colour that Esri used to store colour values inside these layer files. It's not RGB like you'd hope, where it's just, you know, three numbers plugged in there. It's this Scilab LAB format. But all the colour formulas and conversion formulas that are standard for getting between these two colour systems, none of them quite matched up. It would kind of get close, but maybe it'd be like, you know, 30 or 40 difference in that RGB channel. So good enough, but not enough to make me happy. So that's kind of a roadblock, and Slayer kind of just sat dormant for about a year or so after that initial task. Until along came this company, opengis.ch, cool Swiss company, contacted me. They had a customer who had, again, a library of a couple of thousand symbols that they developed over multiple years in these layer files. They were moving to an open source adoption in that enterprise, and they needed to get these symbols out, and they didn't want to do it by hand. So OpenJS threw a bunch of funds at Slayer, and Slayer got powered up by this funding thing, and we threw it at these symbols and basically got them all across and got them all converted into QGIS symbols. So today, this is kind of what it looks like. There's two parts to it. One is the part that reads those layer files and works out all little bits and stuff and converts them into something usable. The second part is like a QGIS plugin, which just puts a front end on this, and offers tools like converting the Esri style files to GPL color palettes and to QGIS style XMLs. Looks a bit like this. You pick your style file and you choose a bunch of settings and stuff, and it gives those symbols out at the end. This is a bit of the current status of of Slayer. So currently only Esri style databases are supported. So unfortunately you still need an ArcGIS license to get your layer file to convert that to a style database, and then you can convert that, but that's going to change. RGB colors are now like passed to plus or minus one for the RGB channels, so we broke that. Fill symbols, pretty much complete support. Line symbols, pretty much complete support. Markers, more or less complete support as well. Color ramps, supported too. So it's got really good conversion. Fortunately, there's a massive overlap between QGIS symbology and ArcGIS symbology, so almost everything we can translate and get looking nearly identical to the original. In the future, so Slayer, at the moment, it's basically made for QGIS color of QGIS conversion, but there's no reason why the same thing couldn't be used and basically throughout SLD or Cardo CSS or whatever other kind of thing out there, so you could directly take your Esri symbology and get out an SLD equivalent of that. In the future, again, so it's kind of a lie. At the moment, you can't get a layer file and convert that. You have to go write that style file. So the number one pressing need for Slayer is to actually directly support layers, so you don't need Esri, you don't need all these kind of other dependencies, and you'll be able to run it on any platform. Also in the future is we've looked into MXD support, and it should be 100% possible. So the holy grail goal here is basically to get your MXD, your ArcGIS map documents, put them into Slayer, and get a QGIS document out the end, which has got all those layer sets in the same symbology. You get your print layouts and all that sort of stuff converted just with a kind of click of the button. That's the goal, and I'm sure we're going to get there. At the moment, that's how you get it. So github.com/Niall Dawson/Slayer, and you can download the kind of beta version of it and convert all your style files into QGIS files.
I think, no, that deserved a mic drop. All right, so next up we've got Andrew Harvey talking about validating and updating OpenStreetMap schools with open data. Please welcome Andrew Harvey.
Hi, so I want to talk about a project I went through to update schools in OpenStreetMap using open data. So the first step was to identify the data source. So in New South Wales, Department of Education have this great open data portal. It's really good. I can just go and search, and quite quickly I found this master data set for New South Wales government schools. It was in a CSV format, so quite easy to use. Done. Step two, license check. It was Creative Commons licensed, so we need a waiver. OpenStreetMap Foundation published this great waiver, so it's very easy, sent it off. I think it was like 2 months later or so they got back to me. But the good news is they agreed to it. They said it's fine to use this in OpenStreetMap under the Open ODBL. So next step was to develop and document a plan. So, first step, as part of that, was to consult the community. So I sent this email to the TalkAU, which is the Australian OpenStreetMap community mailing list. And I said, hey, I'm investigating the possibility of importing this into OpenStreetMap. Your feedback, like, what do people think about this? Should we do it? Shouldn't we? So as part of that, I put together a plan about mapping it into the OSM schema, because they use kind of their own schema, and there was a bit of work to then get it in. So I said, here are the tags like I think we should use. And a few people kind of chimed in and provided some really good feedback to make it better. So it's like, it's good that OpenStreetMap has kind of a process to doing imports, because if I just kind of went in and did it, I would have made a lot of mistakes. So that actually worked really well. So here's an example of the different attributes that were in the open data. All the contact details, address, when the school was built, the grades to the school levels that it offers, if it's like a high school, primary school, is it year 7 to 10 or 7 to 12. Things about specialties, does it offer like distance education, really detailed level of data. So Yeah, and that was basically the import plan. But the next part of that was to actually compare it with what's in OpenStreetMap already. Because there was actually a lot of schools mapped out by the whole OpenStreetMap community. So I did this comparison and found out that there's about almost 500 features from this government open data set that were missing in OpenStreetMap. And another almost 2,000 features, so they're schools, with new or different tags. So either we can improve what's in OpenStreetMap, or there's maybe something that we need to look into further. I can't tell you the other way, like how many schools OpenStreetMap had that weren't in the open government data set, because in OpenStreetMap, public and private schools are all mixed in together most of the time, unless someone's actually added the tags to that. Whereas this is a data set that only had public schools. So I put together, like, this is a script to actually go in and compare that, and it produced this big table of results, which actually matched up the open data and the OpenStreetMap data. And you can see here, all these tags are added in, are new, that we can import. And then it's found a difference in the name. So in this case, there was quite a lot of differences in the name, but most of them are quite like public school versus primary school. And so what we did was to just add, so leave what's in OpenStreetMap at the moment, but just add that as an alternative name to trust like what people have actually surveyed over this. So the next step was to actually do the import. That was quite straightforward, but it took a while because it is the process of going through all this manually to make sure that we don't mess things up. But then there's a remote control plugin for JOSM that makes it really easy that you kind of say, yep, this is okay, I'll go apply in JOSM, and it actually goes ahead and makes that. So in JOSM, we can just hit upload. So lessons. Agencies with open data portals are usually very happy for you to use their data if you talk to them. They're usually quite happy about that. In this case, the source data was very high quality, but it's not always the case, so you need to use a lot of caution. So that's why comparing it to what's in OpenStreetMap, getting some local knowledge is good. Some diversity issues in OpenStreetMap data were revealed, like a lot of, there are schools inside hospitals and they were basically non-existent in OpenStreetMap, so we were able to bring them in. And also there are some specialist schools for children with disabilities that were also quite missing in OpenStreetMap that we were able to add in through this process. So in the future, better software could also help actually run these imports and this was just a once-off, but in terms of keeping it updated as new government data comes in. So just quickly, I also want to talk about open addresses, global data set of, global collection of address points. So in Australia and New Zealand, we have 17 sources. That's all of them, like GNAF, LINS. We process them, we bring them in into a common schema, so it's a global thing. And we process this mostly automatic. I hope in the future it could one day compete with GNAF because we could bring in state data, which is often published like weekly or more, and have a more faster than quarterly GNAF competitor. So check out open addresses. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. No, we've got Ewan Hill, actually. Is Ewan Hill here? Ewan? Cool. So Ewan's going to be telling us, I note your comments about OpenStreetMap comments. So you're on this one here? I don't know how you navigate your slides.
No, neither do I.
Oh, okay. Can you use the arrows? Or? Ewan's chosen not to use PowerPoint and to use something different.
It's a Mac.
Okay, go back to Chrome. So click on this one. Yep. How do you start the show?
Should be down there.
Okay, I can take it out of. Do you need to press that?
Okay.
Should we get the next
bit going? Oh, that's okay. We'll be good. Okay, here we go. Please welcome Ewan Hill.
Thank you.
And thank you to Andrew, who's done a huge amount of work in the OSM area and a lot of the Australian stuff that is there now is courtesy of him. So thank you. The notes system in and the comments within OSM is a small little subset. There's not much to it. You can add a comment to say this is wrong. You can add a comment to say come and to my great online shop, unfortunately. There's a whole lot of different things you can use comments for. There are now over 1.5 million comments. I tried to download the XML file, which was 64 gig of comments, and it was a little bit difficult. So I did tried to do a little bit of a snapshot of the Australian stats, along with New Zealand. All the other Oceania areas were fairly low. So currently we've got 2,950-odd comments that need clarification, rectification. And you can see that as time goes on, more and more comments are coming in. And they're not all being rectified. So what I'd really like is for everyone to go out and just find 10 comments and try and rectify them today. No. The overall comments, Germany is right up there, but if you have a look, Australia and New Zealand down there a little bit, but you know, comments is a hugely popular subsystem of OSM. You can have a look at the bottom graph and you can see that comments are on the increase, and so it is something that we do need to have a look at if we're going to give a consistent approach to OSM. A quick look at the states and territories, and you can see how Northern Territory is pretty good, South Australia, New South Wales, and New Zealand. So all of those Kiwis out there, any Jaffers, please help and fix up one or two of those. The top 11 locations. North Adelaide is probably one of the highest density of issues that I've got. So yeah, go in, click on one of those, you should be able to find it fairly quickly. I'll go through this very quickly. Christchurch, New Zealand, Toowong in southern Queensland, Auckland and Napier. Armidale in country New South Wales, and this is a one that I sadly didn't take a screenshot when I did, but there was one user who actually commented on every path track. However, however, they were all fairly correct. Okay. So we've got the south of Perth, Newcastle, North Perth, and who do you reckon's going to win? So, yeah, there's right around the whole of the Oceania, we need to probably get... Some of these are a year old, 2 years old, and we really need to try and work out how to actually improve the process. Finally, here's a map of somewhere called... Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ewan Hill. All right, next we've got Andrew Bashfield from RMIT. He's going to tell us about using QGIS for teaching land development. Please welcome Andrew Bashfield.
Thank you, Stephen. Okay, so my presentation's about an exercise that we carried out. It was Advanced Diploma of Surveying students, so they're TAFE level students at RMIT University School of Vocational Engineering. And the exercise was all about getting students to conduct an opportunity analysis for their client, in this case, a property developer. And by identifying a top 10 list of potential properties for multi-lot development in the student's own locality, so every student did their own area. The students were responsible for assembling the spatial data sets, conducting the analysis, producing A3 maps and a basic written report. And finally, they published the data on the web in a way that the developer client could see and access interactively. So who are the players in the property development example? Here are some property developers. This is what they look like. They want to win and they want to get rich. We've got to remember that when we're talking about these guys as clients. And the next group are the students, and here they are conducting an asset data capture exercise in Argyle Square in Carlton. As you can see, there's quite an age range, from those recently out of high school to others having worked for a few years to people making a late career change. And here is the tool we use, QGIS. So the first task was actually to gather data, to create a base data for analysis, and the two key data sets were VicMaps, cadastral boundaries, and the urban program, urban development program, broad hectare residential land. And this is what it looks like. So you can see that broad hectare land is basically that land on the outskirts of Melbourne. Now, we also had students coming from the country where this sort of data is not actually mapped. So we had to come up with a definition of broad hectare, and we actually said anything over 10,000 square metres in size. The next data set was features of interest, once again coming from the state government. And the kinds of features of interest we're interested in were transportation facilities, parks, schools, shops, hospitals, and those kind of services that are of interest to property buyers. This example is features of interest in Richmond. So this is a map produced by a student. Here's another example. This is an enlargement of a map produced of North Geelong, once again showing the students' chosen symbology. There are 60 students involved in this program, and all of them choose something different. So the next step was the identification of dual occupancy and multi-lot development opportunities. We call a dual occupancy lot opportunity as something where it's defined as a land parcel that's a size between 1,000 square metres and 2,000 square metres. And a dual occupancy is between 2,000 and 10,000. We were looking for consistency between the councils, and most of the time it was there. So the red ones are multi-lot subdivision opportunities, the yellow ones just a single parcel chopped into half. So the student had to produce a list of their top 10 development opportunities within their chosen neighbourhood. Couple of key criteria. The first one, we're asking them to try and choose corner blocks with dual road frontage to lessen the amount of land that was used up by driveways, rights of access. Second was to choose unoccupied blocks or blocks with only single dwellings, as these were more attractive for the purchase and construction of medium density housing. And here's the kind of examples of the top 10. So in this example, which is Richmond, the students were asked to show on Google Earth whereabouts it was, and also on QGIS with the planning map. A few other examples. Now, what came up a lot was car parks, because there was no one occupying them. And then the next thing was to report on proximity, because we were looking for parcels that were as close as possible to schools and transport. So in this location, which is Balaclava in Melbourne, you'll see that yellow parcel has been calculated as 5 minutes walking distance from Balaclava railway station. The final task was web publishing. The students were asked to provide that interactive method of delivering the data to their clients, not just a paper format. And the assumption was the client wouldn't have GIS, so they'd need a web tool. So we used QGIS Cloud because it was free. And the students were doing all of this on their own laptops, not on RMIT computers, so it was important that they had their own licenses. Here's an example. This is a published web page, and you can see students chose funny little houses rather than colouring up the parcels in this case, but you can see that there's attribution attached to a particular lot. This one is a little better. This is West Meadows next to Melbourne Airport. So the outcomes for the students, they produced a spatial analysis portfolio and website that they could use to help them get their jobs with employers. And what we do is all about producing or creating employability for them. They got a more focused appreciation of the developer's interests and what makes one land parcel more attractive for buyers than the other. And they got hands-on experience with spatial tools, QGIS, QGIS Cloud, and they got licenses that they could take home and actually possibly create a business from them. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Andrew Bashfield. That is fantastic. It's so different from back when I was at uni.
All right, next up we've got Julian O'Grady. He's been telling us about exploring total water levels around Australia using R-Shiny and Leaflet. Please welcome Julian.
All right, so at CSIRO we're interested in how high the total water level is for coastal inundation and coastal erosion. And we're looking to provide this information to coastal stakeholders, coastal councils, for example, through web-based portals. So we're using Shiny and Leaflet. So I'd like to acknowledge my co-authors on the work, which Tim Irwin, who put me onto the Shiny work, and the fellow coastal scientists, Claire, Kathy, and Ron. And we're all based here in Melbourne, down in Aspendale. So how high the water level depends on where you are or where you're measuring it. So in the open ocean, satellites measure the water surface and changes from temperature and density. So that determines how high the water is. In protected coastal estuaries, protected from large waves that you experience on the beach, you can measure coastal increases in storm in water level from storm surge, which is wind and atmosphere piling up water onto the coast, and also tide. So you can determine how high the water level is there. And on open beaches, there are techniques with cameras that measure the effect of waves. As waves, large waves move into the coast, they break, they pile up onto the coast and push water up into the coast. And that determines how high the water level is on the coast from the surge of waves running up the beach. So it's important for sort of coastal assets right near the coastal boundary. So what we wanted to do is develop a nationwide tool where we could access this data. So we're using the Shiny sort of web tool. So the way it's explained to me how Shiny works is that a group of our geoscience ninjas got together with some HTML ninjas, coding ninjas, and they produced Shiny. That's my understanding. So it's, we're using the R statistical, well, I use the R statistical software, libraries for Shiny and Leaflet to generate this web page, which has on the top left some radio buttons to choose which locations to plot on the map, which is a zoomable zoom. You can zoom in, zoom out of the map and click on the different locations. Switch locations to be the tide gauges or to be coastal points. You can zoom into locations. So here I've zoomed into Sydney Harbour and there's a tide gauge located there. So we can click on that point and see what the coastal information is. Or we can show the beaches, the different beaches. So here we've got Bondi Beach highlighted. We click on it and we can produce these plots of return level height. So these are plots that engineers use to determine what a 1 in 100 year storm height might be. Now, the effect of waves on beaches depends on local features like the beach slope. So with this tool, we're able to modify the local beach slope and change these return level periods on the fly to get the local information. So, in conclusion, I guess this isn't the only Shiny web app that's been developed in CSIRO. CSIRO is a big company. And there's many in-house Shiny apps being developed. So the team's building in-house Shiny servers to house or to host all the apps. And from my experience with the coding, I had a little bit of issues getting labels on the names in the Leaflet sort of maps. And by trial and error, down at the end of the code here, I've got the labels in that add circles function equals the tilde space tilde as character name, which is, I don't know how I got to that, but it seemed to work, so I was pretty happy. So if you're interested in the website that we're developing, or this bug, please contact me. And there's my, well, it's not a bug, it's a workaround. There's my contact.
Thank you, Julian. Again, you've got 2 minutes left, Julian. All right. Next up on this computer over here, we have Hamish, and he's going to tell us about how he was famous for a day in New Zealand. So please welcome Hamish.
Let's be honest, it's not that hard. Just really quickly, shout out to the Spatial Community Slack. There's a really cool growing community, international Slack community, thespatialcommunity.org. It's really cool. Go there, sign up. So I just want to talk really quickly about an interesting experience I had this year. So I was working from home in the evening on a beautiful Auckland July, so dark and rainy and horrible. And this tweet came along, and it was someone in Denmark had done a little bit of analysis on what's the most remote location defined as being the furthest away from any structure. And they found this point that was 4.4 kilometres, and it's next to a road. And I thought, David Hood was like, oh, I wonder what this looks like for New Zealand. And I thought, well, if there's one thing we're good at in New Zealand, it's being far away from other places. So let's have a look. And I happen to know that in New Zealand, if you want to be far away from a place, then you're probably going to be on DOC, Department of Conservation Reserve Land. And Land Information New Zealand happens to publish the hut information as points. So there's a good bet that the furthest point away from any location in New Zealand is going to be far away from a dock hut. So over the next, over that evening and into the next morning, I guess, I thought, well, hey, look, let's pull that data down and see if I can mangle my way through this kind of analysis. And I want to say, I'm a software engineer and I mostly deal with sort of SaaS web apps. I use QGIS now and then, but I'm not an analyst, so there are better ways of doing this, but this is just sort of my little process. And also, QGIS has 3D views now, which are really cool, so I thought, hey, the first thing I'll do is put on a 3D map, because that's always cool. You can just, like, tilt it, and now it looks like you're... Yeah, it's cool. yeah, that's really neat. It's a bit buggy, though. I think 3.4 hopefully has improved that a little bit. I haven't used it since then. Yeah, and so I sort of... making my way through, so the first thing I tried to do was kind of I broke it up into squares and looked at different areas, and predictably, well, sure off the bat, you know, you kind of know if you know anything about the geography of New Zealand, you're gonna suspect that it's gonna be in Fiordland because it's massive and almost nothing is there except for some moose maybe, so I thought I'd identify the likely location and then using the hut. Points produce the sort of Fermi polygons. I'm going to mangle the words here. And sort of a whole lot of flailing around later, managed to get something that looked like it was going to produce some kind of result. And unsatisfactorily, I ended up sort of hand moving things around a little bit, and I found this location. It's the yellow dot up there. The blue dots are the centroids of the relative polygons. And because I couldn't figure out how to treat the coastline as not being an edge, I had to manually figure out what was the closest point to that blue dot on the left. And it turns out to be this little point that is on the edge of this unnamed cove deep in Fiordland in the south of New Zealand, which is pretty cool. I figured it was it's about... what'd I say? Call it to plus or minus a kilometre, the south end of the bay, of the Coal River mouth, which is not an official name, some 29.8 kilometres northwest of the Supper Cove hut as the crow flies. So 4.4 kilometres is nothing. And that's right next to a road as well. This thing is it's a 40 kilometre minimum walk from the nearest hut. That's over steep, mountainous, rugged terrain, forest. The hut itself is a four-day walk to the end of a lake. The lake itself, you have to get a boat across from the other end of the lake. If you really want to get there, it's a pretty big journey. You know, it's serious work. The next day, I had this PM on Twitter from a local journalist saying, "Hey, you know, he'd been following along with us. It got a little bit of been shared around the very well-known and enormous New Zealand GIS community." And so, hey, you know, can I talk about it? We had a little chat on the phone that morning. Nick Minnett. yeah, so straight into the New Zealand Herald. It was in the paper that I got in the morning, so I'm a strange person who actually gets a physical paper still, and it had this story in it, which was pretty cool, got to show the kids. And possibly the... my highlight as a dad, biggest dad moment in the car on after school pickup, sitting in the car and Radio New Zealand on the radio and the Jim Mora show in the afternoon, where they talk about mostly inane rubbish. The inane rubbish of the day was my story. So, so that was really cool. For one day, you know, I got to be on the New Zealand Upbeat pages, which was pretty rad. And then someone who actually knows what they're doing, Richard Law, who unfortunately can't be here today, he did, let's do the Rust version in GDEL, and within like a minute confirmed that indeed... something like coding late at night, you know, sometimes just have a sleep, think about it, you know, things will be much easier in the morning. But it was really cool to see, you know, how would someone who really knows what they're doing actually solve this problem really quickly and simply, and Rust analysis with GDEL was the way to go, which is really cool. A couple of days later, this fella, Tillman, replied to me saying, hey, you know, he actually sailed past here on an expedition trip, took a photo, and so you can see a photo of the place up there. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hamish. We love to see inane rubbish. It's what we're all about here. All right, so the other day I had to go to my local council page, and they had a half page of instructions on how to find my address. I live in Australia. I thought that was a bit crazy. So Daniel Castle is going to tell us about a place where it's a lot more difficult to geocode. So where the streets have no name, please welcome Daniel Castle.
Hello. I'm not Australian. I'm German, and I'm living quite a long time now in Japan, and which is far away. And you know, Germany is very well mapped in terms of OpenStreetMap. And some people say you either import Germans or data. And so they chose to import data actually. But when I started mapping in 2007, Japan looked like this, very gray, a lot to do. And it's not easy. So big cities, lots of people in some areas, super dense cities, like you don't know where to start. Also the mapping doesn't really look very beautiful, so the thickness of streets does not work in Japan of the default rendering. And you also have to map highways, what a UK highway is in Japanese, whatever path type. You don't know what it is, actually. And you also have to deal with these kind of things. So real vertical. So GPS signals are not so good at the bottom. And how to draw it, actually. And then you have also buildings that look like this, and a street goes through, that's in Osaka. So one advantage is there are no road names, usually. So there are a few places that have road names, but you just take the GPS track and load this data, upload this data, and you don't have to name it because there's no street name. But then you have something like when you're looking for a place, you have these kind of district maps you can find here and there. So in this case, on the left side, this is like a district, like a local area, and the name of each owner of this property is actually written on this map. And if you, after some time in Japan, actually figured out that the kind of the district where you are is always written on the poles of lights, for example. So when you can read this, you know actually where you are. Otherwise, you have to ask someone to find the address. And the postman actually, I don't know how they know it, but address systems, first, if you don't know them, you don't know really how it works. And the problem happens when you attend a Phosphor G conference. because you go abroad and you have to fill in the correct address to get to send the invoice to your company, and the address of the form does not match with your address. So this is a typical problem where I have to actually bend my address that it looks later on the printout form as I want to have it. And usually wherever you go, you have these kind of house numbering systems, like the European scheme, the clockwise scheme, or whatever. So there are many, many ways how to describe a street address, but I don't have a street address. And so I wanted to tell everyone who makes geocoders, for example, that there are other addresses than street addresses. A Japanese addressing system is based on areas and subdivided from big to small. So you also write the address from big to small. And usually you start with the country, then there's only one, then you have prefectures, and then cities, sometimes you have wards, and then when you are at this level about, then you have districts, small areas, and they are numbered, and within this place you are numbering the houses. And the houses are numbered, depending on the city, by the time when the house was built, or they have some sort of rule. You can easily squeeze a small building inside because you just give it the next highest number. It's actually not so bad. You might think it's inconvenient, but it's for geocoding. It's not so bad because if you know the district, you're actually not so far away. The problem is when you are writing addresses to, for example, to receive a Christmas present, then the left side is the Japanese writing, starting with the postal code and ending with the name. So in the middle, you can see how you would write this Romanization. And on the right side is how you have to turn this around that the actual present reaches you, because Japanese post is actually quite tolerant. So they can read many things, but the German post office would not send this middle address to Japan. And so Japanese addresses are actually also, OSM is also very good to deal with any kind of tagging. So I think the Japanese community made the way through the tagging scheme. The problem is that then the applications often don't support what Japanese mappers map. And that's not enough, because you have actually even more exceptions to street addresses, like South Korea is different, Taiwan is different, Venice has a different address system, and even in Japan there's yet another one. And that's Kyoto, it's quite famous in Japan. And I took these images from a Japanese friend who has a geocoder for this on GeoDOS, and it's a descriptive way how to reach an address. It says, go two streets north and then right. So it describes the way to the address, and people really use it. And the postman knows how to find that place. So this is, just remember, if you write some software with addresses, or if you make a form for your website, there are other countries that don't have Western street addresses. And that's my message.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Right. Next up, we have Rebecca Roberts, and she's going to talk to us about calculating livability across Australia using open data and tools. Please welcome Rebecca.
Thank you. Hi, I'm a GIS analyst at RMIT University, and I'm currently involved in a project calculating livability across Australia using open data and open tools. So what exactly is livability? Well, at RMIT, we define a livable neighbourhood as a neighbourhood which is safe, socially cohesive and inclusive, and environmentally sustainable. Additionally, a livable neighbourhood must also have affordable and diverse housing which is linked via public transport, walking and or cycling infrastructure to employment, education, public open space, local shops, health and community services, and leisure and cultural opportunities. So the following maps, collectively titled Mapping Access to Frequent Public Transport, are an example of one of the many indicators we have created using open data. These maps show the percentage of residences by suburb which are within 400 metres of a public transport stop with a service frequency of 30 minutes or less. We created this indicator for each of the 8 capital cities across Australia to enable comparison both within and between cities. These maps were published in a report called Creating Livable Cities in Australia, which you may also freely download and view. Now, I'd like to explain how we built this particular transport indicator. It's easiest to work backward in the flowchart, so I'll start with our near-end product, which is called the information output. In this case, it spatially identifies which dwellings are within a 400-metre walking distance of a public transport stop, which meets our service frequency specifications of 30 minutes or less. In this example, I'll also refer to Melbourne because slightly different data sets were used to create different indicators for each city. So the information output was derived using the following input building blocks, which are pedestrian road network, dwellings, and frequently serviced stops. We built the road network through OpenStreetMap, but we put this network through a cleaning process, which removed roads such as freeways and busways. This was done to ensure we had modelled a road network which as accurately as possible reflected one on which a pedestrian could legally and safely walk. Dwellings were extracted from the open source GNAF address file, which is located in the Federal Australian Government Spatial Data Repository. And we got the Melbourne Public Transport data from the Victorian Government Spatial Repository. So after we calculated which dwellings were within a 400 metre walking distance of a frequently serviced public transport stop, we then downloaded more open source data, which were the ABS geographic boundaries. And we used these spatial boundaries to aggregate the information up into our final indicators. The final indicators were actually the percentage of dwellings which were within a 400 metre walking distance of a frequently serviced public transport stop, calculated at different scales. All of this data was stored and analysed in a PostGIS database, and we used QGIS to produce the maps for publication. So the creation of this transport indicator is just an example of one of the many many different indicators that we've been creating to model livability. And some of the other indicators that we have done rely on additional open source tools such as NIME and Python, which we use in combination with PostGIS. All of these open data sources and tools have enabled us to successfully calculate and publish these national livability measures across Australia. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca Roberts. Right, next up we have Hugh Summons from IAG Insurance. He's going to talk to us about big data, open source, and ethics. Please welcome Hugh Summons.
Thank you, Steve. I've given myself the challenge of talking about three topics in 5 minutes, so here we go. Okay, I'd like to talk to you today about movement data. What is movement data? Movement data is basically location data from smartphones and GPS devices. It is data that tells you where people have been, where they are going to, tells us where they live, where their home is, where their work is, where their kids go to daycare, where they like to shop, which pub do they like to go to, what team do they support, what football fields do they go to, you name it. What can we use this data for? This data is good for customer segmentation. It is really good for transportation and retail analysis. It is also good for reducing the number of questions required in censuses. I'm not sure about that one. It is also really good in the insurance world for risk modelling. So let's have a look at some examples. So we're looking here at 1% of Melburnians on July 25. This is a 24-hour period. Red trips are long, green trips are short. Another example, some risk data. Here we have someone who doesn't drive very well. So we can see as they go around corners, they're getting higher than usual G-forces, which means they're driving like a Wally. Okay, is this big data? Yes, it is. This is not Google, Facebook grade big data, but it is still big data. Every dot you see on the screen there is 150 bytes or thereabouts. If we're capturing that every 5 seconds, which is could be 1 second, but let's say 5 seconds for the fun of it, and people are moving around at least 4 hours of the day, and we're looking at 1% of Australia, you're looking at 100 gig of data per day. So we're talking about 36 terabytes per year. It adds up pretty quickly. How the heck are we going to manage and process all that data? Well, unless you've got a supercomputer, you're going to need some cloud, a cloud provider to give you some infrastructure to run this lot on. How are we going to process the data in a cost-effective and high-performance manner? You're going to, of course, need some open source. So let's have a look at a couple of contenders of tools that can do this sort of work, GeoMesa and PostGIS. I'm not sure how many people have heard of GeoMesa. It basically allows you to store, index, query, and transform spatiotemporal data at scale. I'm quite proud of the fact I got to say spatiotemporal in front of a large audience. So what is it? It's simple. It's basically a bunch of spatial data types, spatial functions, and indexing for some big data platforms, such as Apache Spark, Kafka, Cassandra, Accumulo, HBase, and a few others. Very powerful tools. These are the kind of tools that are being used by the Facebooks and the Ubers and the Netflixes of the world to manage their data. It allows you to store your data in Hadoop or HDFS, cloud storage systems like AWS's S3, as well as local files if you've got a really whopping big hard drive. We've put together some sample Python code, which allows you to run GeoMesa in Elastic MapReduce in AWS or on your standalone Mac or PC. If you go to the IAG Geo GitHub page, you'll see it there. It allows you to ingest some geo-enabled news data called GDelt, and then do a quick filter just to prove it works. Okay, let's compare against our good old friend PostGIS, which allows you to do exactly the same thing, but in a relational database. Some comparisons. Obviously, it's a bunch of spatial data types, spatial functions, and indexing as well. However, it has more types and functions than GeoMesa. It also has the simple SQL syntax. Now, for those of you who haven't done a lot of SQL, you might say simple. You've got to be kidding. But with GeoMesa, you have to code in Python, Java, or Scala. Right? So there's a little bit more of a learning curve to automate and manage your data in GeoMesa. Postgres, generally speaking, is harder to scale for big data than packaged cloud services. So when I say packaged, things like Elastic MapReduce, which allow you to spin up Spark and Hadoop, reasonably straightforward. If you want to go from 10 servers to 100 servers in Elastic MapReduce, you add a zero onto one parameter. So AWS have made that quite simple. It's a bit more work with Postgres. Okay, PostGIS has some neat things. So you're dealing with billions of records. They're very hard to manage and continue using. What you can do, though, is you can distill that down into some polygons and some lines. So whenever someone stops and they've got little GPS points bouncing around a certain spot, you can do things like DBSAN clustering. You can do point-in polygon queries inside property boundaries, for example, to cluster those points and replace hundreds of points with one record. Similarly with journeys, so all the points that make up someone's journey, you can create an ordered line string. So it's a line string ordered by time, which is a really neat little trick in PostGIS. Okay, last but not least, governance and ethics. Did I mention we know where your children go to daycare? So we've got data, and I say we generally, people working with movement data, we've got data for, say, hundreds of thousands of people, right? This is highly sensitive data, but we want to get lots of juicy insights out of it, right? That's not going to happen without governance and ethics. First things first, secure your data. If you have a data breach, you may have just seen the end of your organization. Either financially, reputationally, or both, you may no longer exist. If anyone's heard of Cambridge Analytica, a little company in London, what they did with Facebook was the end of them. They're gone now. Last but not least, you need to look at your use cases. Are you going to have ethical usage of your data? Are you going to create algorithms which are unfair to certain groups? Are you going to upset or harm people? Because they're going to ruin you as well, financially or reputationally. Thank you.
Thank you, Hugh Salmons. Next, we have Dr. Martin Tomko. He's going to tell us about teaching GIS science using SOS4G. Is there an alternative? Rhetorical question, I like it. Please welcome Martin Tomko.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. It's great to be your host here. And I didn't feel like I can talk about my research, so I'll talk about my day job, which is really teaching. What I'm trying to do is to teach people that can then be in this room, and some are. I'm very proud of that. So the question is, teaching GIS science with SOS4G, is there an alternative? And maybe you think, sure. Or maybe you think, surely not. And that depends on how we understand the title, because I want to talk about GIS science, not about GIS. Sure, you can teach GIS. You can teach people to go and do GIS analysis, but what we are interested to do here is to teach people that can sit in this conference in the future. So let's go through the scientific process a little bit. You have to start with some
question that you are curious to answer and that should hold, and the answer to which should contribute to human knowledge for posterity or until proven incorrect. So you have a hypothesis that you want to test, and you're going to design an experiment around it. You're going to collect some data in a careful manner. You're going to process them. You're going to analyze them. You're going to interpret your results and evaluate and verify those results. And at the end, you can say yes or no. Did you confirm or reject the hypothesis? That doesn't stop there. There's one more step. Your process should be forever, or ideally, verifiable by someone else, not you, by your peers or whoever else is interested in this. Now, how does this apply to spatial? In a GIS process, you do not have that external verification, not necessarily, or you do not depend on it. Anyone can go and do GIS, can do it for a local government, but it doesn't have to be somewhere published, doesn't have to be verifiable, might not hold next year. And that's fine for many things, but not if you want to contribute to a scientific process where the GIS process is part of a scientific process, or what I'm talking about here, if we want to develop new methods for data collection, new methods for their analysis, or for their processing, right? So I'm talking about developing the methods and functions you find in your tools that you're using here. Someone has done research on it. An R-tree has been researched and proven to be more performant than whatever it was before, or perform better than quad-tree, let's say. And that's what we're interested in doing here. So it is the difference about going and getting takeaway from knowing how to cook your meal. Okay? And we want to teach, if we teach GI scientists or technologists that will be implementing results of GI science, to be able to cook something new and understand how it was cooked. So this is something that some of my students see at their exams. We look, let's say, at a Shapley code, and they need to understand it. So I'm not talking about commercial, not commercial here. I'm just talking about whether the source is examinable, which is important for us when we teach. So you know, in some ways, Coca-Cola is open source because it has been shown to someone, and they have been able to say, yes, it's kosher. In that sense, we can say QGIS is kosher or any of the other things. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Next up, we have Steve Bennett, and he's been telling us a couple of little tricks to use with MacBox GL. So please welcome Steve Bennett.
Thank you. I know what you're all thinking, it's the last talk. Thank God we're having a nice, soft, fluffy one with no technical details at all. Too bad. five tricks. Trick number one, animated interactions. So this is just a cute little thing you can do in Mapbox GLGS. For those who don't know what it is, it's like it's an open source web JavaScript library, better than Leaflet. When you click on points, the way we make this work is you just create a new layer with a radius of 0 and then just immediately set it to something other than 0. So in this case, I'm setting it to a radius of 20 pixels, and Mapbox GLJS just can't help itself. It transitions the hell out of anything that changes. next up, this is the least compelling demonstration possible of a really, really cool ability. Basically, Mapbox GLJS lets you symbolize stuff using a couple of options like circles and icons and boring things like letters. But we can actually link anything we want to it using a marker. So you can use the full power of the HTML DOM. So in this case, I've done something really unimpressive. I've put some rounded corners on a box. Ooh. And the way we do that is I'm actually I'm tying it directly to the places in the underlying map data. So in this case, it's a Mapbox streets layer. And what we do is I keep a record of which things I've already attached markers to. I check that the marker hasn't already been created, and if it hasn't, then I'm just going to create one, and I create an HTML element, and in this case, I just apply the class name of rounded label, and I get my oh-so-sexy rounded corners on my label. I'm seriously going to do so much more with this. For instance, you could do you could tie like D3 to it, so you could have like little pie charts on your map, and they would just like be completely attached to the underlying objects in the Mapbox data. It doesn't even have to be your own data. Quickly note down that really long URL, and you can see it for yourself. A choropleth, kind of a standard thing you see in QGIS in you know every other platform, but there's no native support for them in Mapbox. Now, I had to implement them like 3 times for 3 different projects, and it's quite a lot of work to implement Mapbox. Implement choropleths. So I've packaged up all that work in a plugin I've really creatively entitled Mapbox-choropleth, which you can find on npm. So I recommend you use that. Just pass through you know a few dozen friendly parameters. Like the geometry that you're using for your choropleth, the CSV file that you're getting the data from, what color scheme you want, it supports color brewer names, and then obviously details like what are the names of the fields in both the geometry and the CSV file that you're going to tie together, and lo and behold, you get an ugly choropleth. The fourth one, this is not specific to Mapbox by any means, but it's just a technique you don't really see a lot of, visualizing two variables at once using a single point. So you can actually, obviously, change the color of the outside of the circle separately from the inside of a circle. So in this case, this is the City of Melbourne's dynamic parking map. If you didn't know that it existed, well, now you do. You can see which spaces in the city are being occupied right now based on real-time sensors, and you can actually access that data directly and build your own app that uses it. So here I'm just using highlighting the outside of each parking sensor with a color indicating the time restriction. So red is like really short and blue is much longer, and then the inside of the circle tells you whether or not there's a car currently there. And I'm surprised how easy that is to sort of mentally process. Often bivariate maps I find really hard, but I think that actually works quite well. I don't have any code because it's kind of self-explanatory. And then the last one is this kind of visualization where you take a... typically you'd be using like building heights or something as your z-axis if you're doing that, but we can also just use a statistical variable. So in this case, it's the total amount of employment within each of these. I think they're called clue blocks, where clue is the census of land use and employment. So this is data collected by the City of Melbourne by knocking on an awful lot of doors on a revolving basis. And let's just see if this... I tried to sneak in an extra... Oh, this is not the live version? Okay, I tried to sneak in the actual video where you can see this in action, but I guess that isn't going to work. So, which means I've got a minute and a half of questions.
Thank you, Steve Bennett.
Cool mathematician, by the way. Do you like our T-shirts?
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you, Steve.
Well, maybe I'll use my last minute for my own story of fame. A couple of years ago, I can totally relate to the calculating the remoteness area. We created a stupid thing called the Hipster Map of Melbourne. Happened to know a guy who worked at The Age. A week later, it was page 3 of The Age, stupidest website ever, and I will never get over the fact that my biggest moment of impact is a website with no practical value whatsoever. But anyway, cool.
Thank you, Steve Bennett. All right, next up we have Nicola Todic from Bing Maps, or Microsoft. He's going to tell us how Bing Maps Australia is now using open data. So please welcome Nicola.
Hey. Thanks everyone for having me here. My name is Nicola Todic. I'm actually living in Serbia, and I've been building the Australian map from Serbia for Microsoft for the past year. So at a high level, this July, Microsoft Bing Maps has Australia continent being served to a portion of our users. It's entirely based on open data, OpenStreetMaps, ABS, open addresses. So we provide the whole set of services on top of this data, routing, rendering, geocoding, etc. So we're doing this, I mean, we're just starting with Australia. We want to surface the best maps data to our customers, and we want to empower the open community, essentially for an outreach. They can have much more impact by going through Microsoft products. the challenge is OSM and other open data good enough? And I guess it's going to take time to persuade people that that's the case. So why Australia? It's an important market for Microsoft, obviously. It's an isolated continent, which we can easily stitch. And the big plus for that was that the government mandated the government data to be open. So we had to fork our entire service stack in order to ensure that the open data does not in any way get mixed up with the proprietary data. So OSM Australia, we had a belief it's great, but we kind of wanted to see what's good about it, what's not. The Cardo feature is absolutely amazing, and the data is fresh and up to date. What we found that the data lacked was the coverage in administrative areas, term restrictions, address point data, and paved, unpaved attributes on the road. So we had to do something about it. Yeah, so as I said, the map is up to date, really up to date. Like, what I'm showing here is some road development that still doesn't exist in the satellite imagery, but we have it in OSM. And this is what we routinely see when we look at all the geographies across the world. The community is incredibly active in updating recent road development. And so this is also common with OSM. The places that are less populated really get less attention. So the administrative polygon coverage, the red dots are representing the points from our test sets where we don't have coverage in OSM. Address points, I mean, we have only 10,000 address points inserted in OSM. And big thanks for Open Addresses for aggregating all of this data for us to use it. On the term restriction front, we have analyzed the data. The big important number here is that we have 0.5% of the routes that we plot to our users that are essentially taking you to a turn where the turn is forbidden. So we had to do something about this as well. So what we did is we employed some people. I'm a big fan of our editorial team. Here they are on the OSM list, like at the top 10. They've, across the last year, they've imported and actually drew more than 100,000 kilometers of road in OSM, added more than 20,000 term restrictions. This really helped us out in building a solid routing engine. And finally, for the paved, unpaved attributes, we have more than 300,000 kilometers of road in OSM, which doesn't have the tag whether it's paved or unpaved. So we had to build a machine learning algorithm using essentially computer vision, deep learning, and their infrastructure to process all of the Australian tiles and essentially do the tagging ourselves. Unfortunately, we cannot do the import to OSM, but that's something we're definitely considering just pulling on GitHub. And finally, we need your help. So, I mean, this is the first time we're doing this. We have on the order of 100,000 user queries hitting the Australian map every day. We need feedback on our services, on the data, and we need you to keep editing the map. I think it's incredible what the Australian community has done thus far. And then together we can really make the best map in the world.
Thank you, Nicola.